All right, let's wrap up our section on continuity with one more incredibly useful theorem called the Intermediate Value Theorem. So what the Intermediate Value Theorem says is this, and I will abbreviate this IVT for Intermediate Value Theorem. And what it says is this. It says, suppose that we have a continuous function, which is why it falls in this section, because we've just defined continuity. Suppose we have a continuous function on a closed interval, and if L is some number in between f of a and f of b, then there must exist a value c in the open interval from a to b, such that f of c is equal to L. Okay? So what does that mean? Well, let's just draw a little visual. So draw a function. Draw your favorite continuous function. You can, if you're following along in your notes, you can copy what I'm writing, or you can draw any continuous function. So remember, intuitively, what it means to be a continuous function is that you're not going to lift up your pencil or your pen as you're drawing the function from f of a to f of b. So I'm going to start here, and I'm just going to draw. There's my little continuous function. I didn't lift up my pen once as I traveled from f of a, which is right here, as I traveled from x equals a, the point a, f of a, to the point up here, which is f of b up here on the y-axis. Okay, so here's this ordered pair a, f of a, and as we traveled from that point, we made sure to draw a continuous function b, f of b. Okay. So we have this nice continuous function. And what the intermediate value theorem says is this. It says that if you pick any number L that is between f of a and f of b, so go over to your y-axis, pick any number you want, even if your graph doesn't look like mine, pick any number in between your f of a and your f of b, identify where f of a and f of b lie on your y-axis, pick any number L that's in between those two, and draw a horizontal line across the graph. And it will hit your graph if you've drawn a continuous function. Then that horizontal line, and you've made sure to draw L in between f of a and f of b, then that horizontal line will hit your curve at least once. Meaning there is a value, track that down to the x-axis, there is at least one. It might hit in more than one spot. If I had drawn L, let me just show you real quick. If I had drawn L, say right here, if that had been L, let's call that L2. If I had drawn L2 right there, notice that it's actually crossing in two spots, but it hits in at least one spot. Okay. And it hits in at least one spot. Here it is. Here's my C, such that F of C is equal to whatever that L value is. And intuitively, this should make sense, because if you have a continuous curve, it means that you can trace the curve without lifting up your pencil across that interval from A to B. And if you can do that without lifting up your pencil, you must cross any horizontal line that's in between f of a and f of b. That has to happen at least one time, okay? Because the only way that you could not cross it would be to jump over it or to have some sort of a hole in the graph. But all of those things would imply a discontinuity, and we guaranteed that the function was continuous on that interval. Okay, so that's what the intermediate value theorem says, and intuitively we now have a graph. So how do we use the intermediate value theorem? Well, we could use it for an example something like this. So let's suppose that we have an equation, negative x to the fifth plus 2 square root of x equals 4 x squared minus 5. And I want to show that that has at least one real root on this open interval from 0 to 3. So how can I do that? How do I put these pieces together about finding roots and this intermediate value theorem? Well, the first thing we should do is we should probably think about what does it mean to have a root. And to have a root, that means that there is a solution in this interval from 0 to 3 to the equation. Okay, so there is at least, we're trying to show that there's at least one solution. That's what it would mean to have one real root. So why don't we start by actually writing a function that we can talk about? If it's, we can talk about the continuity of it, we can talk about what its values are. And so this is not obviously a function, it's just written as an equation. So what I'm going to do first of all is I'm going to take negative x to the fifth plus 2 square root of x. I'm going to subtract the 4x squared and add the 5 so that I get that equal to 0. And then I'm going to take this and I'm going to define that as a function. So let's define a function so that we can work with a function and talk about continuity. Let's define a function f of x to be equal to negative x squared plus 2 root x minus 4x squared plus 5. Okay? And when we do that, let's also talk about the domain, because where we're at right now with continuity is that we've talked about all of the algebraic functions that we know and algebraic combinations of functions that we know, be it, through the algebraic operations of addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, or even composition, will be continuous on their domains. So it is important to find the domain. So let's talk about the domain. So what is the domain of f of x? Well, basically we have an addition of a polynomial plus a root function. So polynomials are continuous everywhere, but we also have the root function. Root functions are continuous where, if it's an even root, the argument of the root is positive. So the domain of this function, and this is because of the root, okay? So I'll just put that there as a note. But the domain of this function is actually all x is greater than or equal to 0. So we could write this as set notation, however you want to write it. It's a set of x's such that x is greater than or equal to 0. Or in interval notation, which is probably more commonly going to be used in this course, it's the interval from 0 to infinity. So this, again, just a quick little overview with domains. This is set notation. And this is interval notation. And we do tend to look more at the interval notation, but it's not incorrect to write it in set notation. It's just different notation. So we do tend to write in interval notation. All right. So now we've defined a function, and we know that its domain is from 0 to infinity. So if its domain is from 0 to infinity, then this function is continuous on its domain. So now let's discuss the continuity. So let's talk about continuity. Okay. This is going to be continuous. F of x is going to be continuous on its domain. So f of x is continuous, meaning I could trace this graph without lifting up my pencil if I was actually graphing it, is continuous on its domain. So it is continuous from 0 to infinity. Well, that of course implies, keep this all on the screen here. That of course implies if it's continuous on its domain, then it must be continuous. F of x is continuous on the closed interval from 0 to 3. So it must be continuous on the closed interval from 0 to 3, okay? Which is what we're trying to show, that it has at least one root on the open interval from 0 to 3. But to use the intermediate value theorem, let me just bring it back here. To use the intermediate value theorem, we have to first show that we are continuous on the closed interval from A to B. So in our case, our A and our B are 0 and 3, and we're showing that we're continuous from 0 to 3. Okay. All right, so we have shown that. So now, just briefly, let me say this. We're trying to now show that we have at least one real root somewhere from 0 to 3. So what would that mean? Well, a real root on the interval from 0 to 3 would imply that f of x, the function we've defined, equals 0 for some, well, let's actually not just say f of x, let's say f of c. F of c is equal to 0 for some C in the interval from 0 to 3. That's what we're trying to show. To have a real root on that interval, that would imply that f of C must be equal to 0 for some C between 0 and 3. That our L value is actually 0. What we're trying to show here is that we have an L value that's equal to zero, that we will somewhere we will pass through that x-axis, meaning that we need to show that one of these points is below the x-axis and one of these points is above the x-axis. And since it's continuous, it must pass through the x-axis. So graphically, what we're talking about is something like this. I don't know what this thing looks like. We'll get a better sense of it here in just a second. But here's zero and here is three. And we know we have a continuous function. We want to show that it passes through this x-axis. That's when f of x is equal to zero. We want to show that it passes through the x-axis at least one time on that interval. Well, if at zero we were above the x-axis, and then who cares what happens if we're continuous and we end up below the x-axis at three, then we would know that we have at least one real root. Right? So to have a real root from 0 to 3, what we're saying is that f of c must be equal to 0 for some c between 0 and 3. All right. So that's what we're saying. I'm going to erase it. We're actually going to show it officially for this function. So to have a real root, that must be the case. So let's check f of 0 and let's check f of 3. Okay, let's see what those values are. So if I plug in 0, and I need to get my function back on the screen so that we can plug it in. There it is, define where we defined the function. So notice if I plug in 0 right there, we're going to get 5, because negative 0 squared plus 2 times the square root of 0 minus 4 times 0 is 5. So we get 5. Okay, and if we plug in 3, 3 is negative, oh, you know what, I just looked over here and I realized that when I wrote the function, I wrote x squared, but that was a fifth power, negative x to the fifth. Okay, so we would have negative 3 to the fifth plus 2 times the square root of 3 minus 4 times 3 squared plus 5. And let's see, negative 243 plus 2 root 3 minus 36 plus 5. And then we keep going and we end up with approximately, and I'm just going to do the approximation here, because obviously the root 3 is going to give us an irrational number. This becomes approximately negative 270.5. I have to look at my calculator. There we go. So notice that back to what we had talked about, we've got a function here. So now I said we were going to actually be able to clean this up a little bit. We actually have a function here that starts at, so if this is 0, and let's go 1, 2, 3. We have a function that starts up here at 5. Let's say that's 5. So that's the point 0, 5. And over here at 3, it's way down. My scale is going to be off here, but it's way down here at 3, negative 270.5, or approximately. And we already showed that it was continuous. We already talked about the continuity. There is no way to travel from here to here without lifting up my pencil and not pass through the x-axis. So I don't know exactly what this looks like, but it doesn't even matter. Like, we know that if we have a continuous function, we will have to pass through the x-axis at least once, meaning that we will have at least one real root from 0 to 3. That's what the intermediate value theorem says. We just need to put it together. So now we're going to say, so the fifth step is just to apply the intermediate value theorem. Apply the intermediate value theorem to our function. Okay, so we can say, since f of x is continuous on the closed interval from 0 to 3, and f of 3 is less than 0, which is less than f of 0, okay? Remember, that's negative 270 and 5, so we could put those actual values in. There must exist at least one value, x equals c, such that f of c is equal to 0 on, and let's say it this way, such that f of c equals 0, where c is in the open interval from 0 to 3, which means that we have a root. That's exactly what that means. That means that we actually have a root or a solution to this equation. So that means that f of c being equal to 0 means that there is one real root on the interval from 0 to 3. That's what we've just shown. And it's by the intermediate value theorem. We had to use the intermediate value theorem to show that. Okay? And that's our proof. So if you're going to apply the intermediate value theorem, you might start with a function. You might have been given this function. We weren't actually given a function here. We were given an equation, right? And so to use the intermediate value theorem, the first thing we had to do was define a function and then talk about the continuity of the function. And these two steps really do go hand in hand, steps 2 and 3, because as we've discussed with continuity, the continuity of all the functions that we've worked with up to this point in the class are going to be continuous on their domains. And so knowing the domain will tell us the continuity of the function. And then, of course, if this function is continuous from 0 to infinity, it is then going to be continuous from 0 to 3. And then to have a real root, that means that the function itself has to be equal to 0, somewhere in between 0 and 3. And so we can look at the two endpoints. So we're checking endpoints right here. And when we check the endpoints, these are the two endpoints. We're checking the endpoints to see if one lives above the x-axis and one lives below. So we're checking endpoints here, endpoints of the interval from 0 to 3. So we're checking those endpoints from 0 to 3. We can show that one is below the x-axis, one is above the x-axis. Therefore, we have to pass through the x-axis. F of x has to be equal to 0, at least at one point C, somewhere between 0 and 3. All right, let's get that all on the screen there so you can take a look. So there is applying the intermediate value theorem to show that an equation has one root.